of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In the waters of baptism, Leo died with Jesus Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory. That your Son died and rose again. Mercifully grant that through this mystery, your servant Leo, who has fallen asleep in Christ, may rejoice to rise again through him, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Please be seated for the liturgy of the word.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. The souls of the just are in the hand of God, and no torment shall touch them. They seemed, in the view of the foolish, to be dead, and their passing away was thought an affliction, and their going forth from us utter destruction. But they are in peace. For if in the eyes of men, indeed, they be punished, yet is their hope full of immortality. Chastised a little, they shall be greatly blessed, because God tried them, and found them worthy of himself. As gold in the furnace, he proved them, and as sacrificial offerings, he took them to himself. Those who trust in him shall understand truth, and the faithful shall abide with him in love. Because grace and mercy are with his holy ones, and his care is with his elect. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
reading from the second letter of Timothy. For I am already being poured out like a libation, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have competed well, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. From now on, the crown of righteousness awaits me, which the Lord, the just judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearance. The word of the Lord.
Lord be with you.
With your
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you.
At that time, Jesus answered, I give praise to you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for although you have hidden these things from the wise and the learned, you have revealed them to the childlike. Yes, Father, such has been your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wishes to reveal him. Come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart. And you will find rest for yourselves, for my yoke is easy and my burden light. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated.
My first experience of Leo Carlin was irritating. Forty-two years ago, I was the gift of God to St. Matthias Parish as a newly ordained priest. As literally and figuratively low man on the totem pole, I had the 6:30 Mass every day. And you have to understand, I'm fresh, I'm new, I'm gifted. So I'm saying the 6:30 Mass this one Monday. At 6:33, the wooden outer doors open, little light comes in. Into the vestibule, I think there's somebody shadow boxing. The man was tying his tie. At 6:35, the inner glass doors open, and this man sort of snuck out, the doors slammed, and he went into a pew.
So that happened Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Friday, I asked the sacristan, Matt, there must be a guy from outside the parish who is late every blankety-blank day. He looked at me. He said, he lives across the street. His name is Leo Carlin. You understand my irritation? Good. In the ensuing 41 years, I think it's safe to say he loved me and I loved him. One of my dearest friends and my dearest confidants. But he was irritating at the beginning. God's word to us is strong and clear. The souls of the just are in the hand of God, and no torment shall touch them. They are in peace. For God tried them, and God found them worthy of himself. As we come to mourn the loss of Leo Carlin, rightfully we are overwhelmed with feelings of sadness, of loss, of anguish. However, God promises that those who live lives of faith and charity, meaning the just, are in his hands. They're safe. They're at peace. You'll agree with me. Leo was a just man, a man of faith and charity. And through all of his life's experiences, the highs and the lows, God found him worthy of himself. Think of that phrase. God found Leo worthy of himself. Now that's the consolation we need to hear, that God found Leo worthy of himself. As followers of Jesus Christ, we know that God showed his love for humanity in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Christ's victory over death, Christ's victory over sin, Christ's victory over meaninglessness is the proof of God's love and compassion for each of us, for all of us, for everyone. Christ's victory is the source of the safety and peace of God offered to Leo. Christ's victory is the source of the safety and the peace of God offered to you and to me. A couple hours after Leo's death, Kay and I were discussing his funeral. Kay started the conversation with, "We must have the reading," which starts, she's always so subtle, "We must have the seating," that starts. I'm going to get paid back on that one. She said, "We have to have the reading that says, I have competed well, I've finished the race, I've kept the faith." And you heard that proclaimed today. It's obvious, right, why we use that reading. You can hear Leo say, "I competed well, I finished the race, I've kept the faith." I've competed well. He was a competitive guy, huh? He wanted the best for his wife and family. He worked his rear end off at work, and he played hard. He always wanted to win, always wanted to win, and he usually did. I have a little story about winning. Leo had a history, a reputation at the vet, that old stadium, where they had built a racquetball court. And he was the king, the emperor of that court. If you heard him talk, no one ever beat him. No one ever got a point off of him. Eagles staff, Eagles players, nobody. Eagles hired a new quarterback. And Leo heard that this guy played racquetball. So Leo said, would you ever like to play racquetball? The guy said, yeah, sure. You name the day and I'll play racquetball. So Leo and this guy went down, his quarterback, went down, and this guy smoked him. 3 games straight, Leo got 0 points. After the match, Leo's walking out, and he says to Jim McMahon, where do you play racquetball? Jim McMahon looked at Leo and said, in the courts in my home. I offer that true story to you because it shows two parts of Leo Carlin. He was competitive, and he was humble in loss, but he never liked losing. We can hear Leo say, I finished the race. Now, he promised or threatened Kay that he'd live to 100. He didn't make it to 100. But goodness gracious, he lived every darn day to the fullest. He wanted to finish the race. And in my mind, to my eyes, he finished his race with grace and beauty. He finished the race, if you will, almost on his own terms. I've kept the faith. I'm fighting with myself, should I call him a Christian gentleman or a Christian character? Call them both? Yeah, he was a Christian gentleman. He loved God and he lived his faith to the best of his ability. He also tried to unlock the mysteries of God. A few years after he retired from the Eagles, he gave me a call and he said he wanted to meet with me regularly to talk about life. Nothing else to do. So, one afternoon at Casey's Pub in Newtown Square, he said he wanted to discuss with me his theology of the Holy Trinity. Where else would you talk about the Holy Trinity but Casey's Pub? He proceeded to present his understanding of this beguiling mystery. He said to me, PJ, God the Father is in heaven overseeing everything. That's his role. That's his job. But he's distant up there. His words, not mine. He said then, however, God wanted us to see him and to hear him. So God became human in Jesus Christ. God wanted us to know, in Leo's words, that he's one of us. Then he said, finally, God never wants us to be distant from him. So God the Father sent the Holy Spirit to be with us constantly, reassuring us of God's presence, reassuring us of God's love. Who knew that Casey's Pub would be a theology class? But it was. And this priest was schooled in theology by Leo Carlin. I think all of us can honestly hear him say, I've competed well. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith. Today, you and I come to say a loving farewell to this Christian gentleman. We do so with so much sadness, so much anguish. But we do so with hope. Eternal hope in God's goodness, in God's mercy, in God's love. My dear friends, God says to you and to me, come to me, all who are labored and burdened, and I will give you rest. God invites each of us, all of us, to place our trust in him. God invites all of us to find our security in him. God invites each of us to acquire peace from him. My dear friends, Leo accepted God's invitation to follow him. And Leo is at rest with God forever. May we also, you and I, accept God's invitation to follow him by living lives of faith and charity, so we also can be at rest with God forever. Amen. Please stand for the petition. My dear sisters and brothers, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we join our prayers to his.
The response is, Lord, hear our prayer, that the bishops, priests, and all who preach the gospel may be given the strength to express in action the word they proclaim. We pray, Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the safety and welfare of all those who stand in harm's way to protect and to defend the lives of others, including our military, those in civil service, and all of our first responders. We pray, Lord, hear our prayer.
For leaders around the world, that they might find ways to bring an end to war and violence and promote peace, love, and justice for all. We pray, Lord, hear our prayer.
In baptism, Leo received the light of Christ. Lord, scatter the darkness now and lead him over the waters of death. We pray. Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us gathered here, that we will love each other so as to make God's love the foundation of our personal interactions and therefore foster the building of God's kingdom on earth. We pray. Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us gathered here to worship in faith, Lord, send your Spirit, the Comforter, upon us that we may be strengthened to walk in faith and hope all the days of our lives. We pray.
For Leo's parents, brothers, and sisters, for Kay's parents and brother, and for the residents of Brightview who have preceded Leo in death, may they all welcome him home into the fullness of a life that never ends. We pray. Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the people who experience a life of suffering, that they may not give into discouragement, but overcome with the strength of faith, knowing that gathered together with the brothers and sisters, Christ will hear their prayers and grant them victory. We pray, Lord, hear our prayer.
Our brother Leo was nourished at the table of the Savior. Lord, welcome him into the halls of the heavenly banquet. We pray. Lord, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, we present to you all of these needs. May we be more aware of your grace in our daily lives. We ask this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Just my shadow.
pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice
of your hands, for the praise of the Lord and the name of our Holy Church. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Leo, we beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, and Eternal God, through Christ the Lord. In him, the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful, Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and the powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we now acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise, that through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Pray the Lord and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, now as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth. With your servant, Francis, our Pope, Nelson, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own.
Listen graciously to the prayers of this family you have now summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
Remember your servant, Leo, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters, too, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you, and for all the ages, and praise you without end through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Please stand. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days that, by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give to you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace and the joy of the risen Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Extend one another Christ's peace.
Thank you.
Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word. Thank you. Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body and blood, food for our journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our dear brother Leo may come to the eternal table of Christ. We ask this through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for the words of remembrance.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We can do better than that. Good morning. A quick little story before we get started. My dad co-authored a book a few years ago with Paul Domowicz about his life and his time with the Philadelphia Eagles. It was about a year ago. My dad was just starting to fail. We were sitting at a table at Brightview, waiting for some guests to arrive. There was a moment of silence, and out of nowhere, my dad asked me if I was going to give his eulogy. I told him that I would if that's what he wanted. He then looked at me and said, "I have a favor to ask of you." Now I'm like, oh boy. So there's a pit in my stomach, and I feel my eyes starting to well up. And I try to maintain my composure, and I say, "Sure, Dad, what is it?" His response was classic Leo Carlin. And with a twinkle in his eye, he said, "Can you keep it short and just tell them to buy the book?" So I guess the pressure's on. Buckle up, everybody. My mom, Kay, my siblings, Lizanne, Clayton, Corinne, Chris, Lawrence, Carrie, and I would like to take a moment to acknowledge and thank some very special people who helped care for and support my dad in the last few years of his life. Laurie, Crystal, Joshua, Dwanda, Jordan, Jackie, and the entire staff at Brightview would always provide a smile and some comfort in very trying times. Melanie, Ophant, Martine, Abby, Tim, Ty, Diamond, Sharon, and Alan, and all the others at Senior Helpers, Mainline Hospice, Five Star Home Care, and Amada Senior Care. These are incredibly special people that worked tirelessly and went above the call of duty when it came to caring for our dad. We are eternally grateful for all your love and kindness. Dr. Bernard King, my friend, my confidant, my consigliere, there are not enough words to thank you for your everyday care, love, and concern throughout the years. The entire Carlin clan is forever grateful. I do try to thank Dr. King by bringing him to the Overbrook member guest every year. And it certainly isn't for his golfing abilities. It's just to say thank you. 20 plus years, we never finished in the money. To Father Lowe, Monsignor Matz, Father Burr, Father Jagodinsky, Father Gallagher, thank you from the bottom of our hearts for giving our dad the send-off that he deserves. Father Lowe, or PJ as we call him, has been a friend to the Carlins for a lifetime. He is a gift to all of us. Our family would like to thank my sisters, Lizanne, Corinne, and Carrie. They were on the front lines of caring for my dad in the last years of his life. While there were certainly a few good text fights, every once in a while, the amount of work and time they put in for my dad cannot be measured. The love and care for him during this very difficult last year is something that I will never forget. They were tireless and dedicated daughters who most definitely deserve a shout out. Thank you. Lastly, we would like to thank all of you. As I look out on this crowd, I know Dad is smiling right now, seeing how many lives he touched. The outpouring of love and support has been overwhelming. The voicemails, the texts, the food deliveries to our homes, the flowers, the messages all over social media have touched us in ways you could never imagine. We have heard all of you loud and clear. Our hearts are filled with your love, your kindness, and your generosity. Thank you. Okay, Dad, now we're on the clock. Let's go. And so we begin. Love, humility, and a smile. That was our dad. It's never easy to honor your hero. Our dad was always unstoppable to us. So in some ways, this is a day that was never supposed to come. And that makes it even harder now to sum up our dad's amazing life, huge heart, and loving spirit in a few minutes. Dad gave us the most unforgettable ride, filled with love, laughter, courage, and tears. Just the other night, while we were going through some pictures, someone said, "What a ride." Indeed it was. It was magical. Our ride was a gift from a man who really had no boundaries when it came to loving and caring for others. Dad was a giant. He was a giant in his professional world. He was a giant in his personal world, and he was a giant in his spiritual world. His smile and kindness lit up the room as soon as he walked in. His ability to connect with people made him a legend in the NFL, in our communities, and to anyone he met. Most importantly, our dad loved fiercely. He loved without hesitation. He loved with every ounce and energy he had. He was passionate about letting people know how he felt. There is a verse from Romans in the Bible that says, "Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, nor any height nor depth, nor anything in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ our Lord." That is the kind of love that describes our dad. An unconditional love that filled people's hearts. One that is so deep, it is beyond comprehension. Everyone who knew him felt it, and they could not help but love him back. One of our dear cousins may have said it best, and I quote, "The man was pure joy. No one made you feel more heard or more loved. His glass was always more than half full. It was always overflowing with love, optimism, and affection. One of a kind. I am blessed to have had him as an uncle," end quote. It is nearly impossible to define my dad in just a few words. He was a loving husband, a devoted father, a doting grandfather, a U.S. Marine, devout Catholic, ticketing savant, ukulele player, a fierce protector, a Frankie Valli fan, a Jaime's roast beef and Russian on rye lover. A Seagram's VO drinker, otherwise dubbed as a VO for Leo, a friend and a mentor. He was dynamic and invested in everyone he met. I came across a quote that describes my dad perfectly. Quote, "You can easily judge the character of a man by how he treats those who can do nothing for him," end quote. This was our dad. His character as a husband, a father, and a man was impeccable. And he did it all with love, humility, and a smile. Dad was a simple man. He had three priorities in his life: faith, family, and the Philadelphia Eagles. Of course, my mom would argue that it wasn't always necessarily in that order. But that's a conversation for another day. Faith. Dad's faith was undeniable. He went to daily mass pretty much every day of his adult life. And when he wasn't able to drive anymore, I would often get the early morning phone call telling me that he thinks I needed a little God that morning. They were days that I treasured. I sat next to my dad in the back of church in his later years and watched him pray. Dad fiercely loved the Lord. He was who he was because of his love for Jesus and his unending faith in God. As life became a little more difficult, I would often walk into my parents' apartment in the morning to find my mom and dad sitting in the living room, watching Mass on TV, both with a rosary in their hand. "Be not afraid" is one of the most common phrases in the Bible. We often overlook its true meaning. Not Dad. Dad suffered in the last year of his life, but he was never afraid. His faith and love for God made him the most courageous man I have ever known. I was at my parents' apartment the night before my dad died. He was sitting in his chair. I could just tell by the look in his eyes and the way he was breathing that his time was near. He had fought so hard for so long. I leaned in and whispered in his ear, "Dad, it's okay to go home. You don't have to worry about us anymore. I will take care of things. I love you very much." I pulled my head away to see a very small smile. And when I looked in his eyes, I saw God's love smiling back at me. Family. Dad fiercely loved his family. He wasn't just our dad, husband, father-in-law, or daddy-o. He was our protector, our caretaker, our best friend. In short, he was our everything. He adored my mom. They met on a blind date, which quickly progressed to my mom sneaking out of the window at Misericordia Nursing School on Fridays to head down the shore with Dad. They were married for 64 years. He affectionately called Mom Felix from The Odd Couple, as he was certainly her Oscar. Two total opposites that fell in love, raised seven children, and actually stayed in love through all of it. They say as parents, the greatest gift you can give your children is to love one another. We were blessed with that gift. Just one of the many examples of my dad's love for my mom and family was, not only our mom's mom, grandmom, but also my mom's mom's sister, Auntie Mamie, were welcomed by my dad to live with us in the last few years of their lives. So if you're counting, that's 11 people ranging from ages 10 to 80 in a 5-bedroom Balakinwood home with a dinner table made for seven. total chaos. But my dad handled it with love, humility, and a smile. Mom, Felix, Dad adored you and the life you made together. Dad's love for his children and grandchildren was unconditional, sacrificial, patient, kind, humble, selfless, and faithful. We always knew we were loved. My sister Corinne recently sent me a text that probably says it best, and I quote, "Dad could communicate with just his eyes. He told me what was most important to him was that I knew I was loved so much by him. So, so much, Rennie," he would say. "He wanted this imprinted on me and triple-checked often. He delivered this love in soft words, sometimes loud words, and often in song. But in his final moments, he delivered this with his sparkling blue eyes and his gentle, radiant smile. I was always sure he loved me. I still am," end quote. This certainly rings true for all of us. Dad loved all of us so, so much. And the best part is, we knew it. Dad gave us the great gift of believing in all of us, and he was our constant protector. One particular story comes to mind. It involves my brother, Chris. Who, if you know Chris, he is always guilty until proven innocent. Chris was in middle school, and my dad got a call from the principal to tell him several of his teachers would like to meet. While in the meeting, my dad and Chris sat and listened while the teachers ranted and raved about Chris and his behavior. They were so animated that they were talking over each other and cutting each other off. Dad listened and never said a word. When they were finished, he stood up and looked at all of them, and he said, "I am aware I'm not raising an angel, but he is certainly not the devil you are making him out to be." He then walked out with Chris. When they got home, my dad turned to Chris and said, "Don't you worry about what they said about you. I know what I see." Chris would later say that that day gave him the strength and courage to believe in himself, and he often thinks back on that day as a changing point in his life. Love, humility, and a smile. It wasn't always the kids that caused the chaos in Ballot Kinwood. Dad was certainly a significant contributor. As a young father, against my mom's wishes, he played in a rough touch football league. My sister Lizanne found him in the basement one day, bleeding profusely from his mouth. He asked Lizanne to grab some ice. Turns out Dad had a broken jaw. Lizanne was pretty young at the time, and all my dad could think of to say to his young daughter was, "Don't tell your mother." A broken jaw, a bloody mouth, and don't tell your mother? Really? Mom ended that career very quickly. He was daddy-o to his 22 grandchildren, a role he cherished and took on with such ease. He was often on the sidelines of games to watch them play. He loved sitting around and telling his old Eagle stories to all of them, and he always was there for a hug, to comfort and to love. Dad was always a little larger than life to all of us. He took up a lot of space in our lives, and his loss leaves a big hole in our family. What remains is his amazing legacy in all of us, and we, the Carlin clan, will carry his love, spirit, energy in our hearts forever. Thank you, Dad. Dad loved the Philadelphia Eagles. He loved the owners, the coaches, the administration, the players, and especially the fans. He poured his heart into 55 years of service. He often had offers from other teams around the NFL and even from other professional sports teams in Philadelphia. His response was always the same. I'm a Philly guy, and I'm an Eagles guy. He was a pioneer in the ticket business and was one of the leaders in introducing computer data processing to the NFL. He was instrumental in moving season ticket holders from Franklin Field to Veterans Stadium to Lincoln Financial Field. He actually moved the season ticket holders three times, as the week before the first game at Veterans Stadium, he was told that the stadium would not be ready, and he had to move everyone back to Franklin Field. There were no computers back in those days, so it was all done manually. Of course, he pulled it off with the help of many, including my mom, who was down there counting tickets and stuffing envelopes. And that week, there was an article in the paper that called my dad the toughest Eagle of them all. Nobody was more popular than my dad during football season. There was even a former Philadelphia mayor that said publicly, there is only one poor person more powerful than me in this city from August through January, and that is Leo Carlin. Dad was nominated for the NFL Hall of Fame and was inducted into the Eagles Hall of Fame. He was a ticket and Philadelphia icon. When the Lake Placid Olympics needed help, they came to Dad, and of course he stepped up. He handled the counting and distribution for all the tickets to those Olympics. I remember counting those tickets and stuffing envelopes in our basement. It is truly a special memory. Dad was able to count tickets by sound, by fanning them out in his hand, holding them up to his ear, and using his thumb to fan through them and listen. Often people would hand him a bunch of tickets to watch him do it. He would hand them back after a few seconds and give them the count. People were always amazed. It was quite a talent, charming and magical. I'm trying, Dad. I'm almost there. As someone with the same name, I often get, are you related to the Eagles guy? When I say I am, I always get back something like, what a great guy. He helped me out and he didn't even know me. Or, wow, you must be proud. He's quite the legend. Please know, Dad, we are proud, very proud. Most of all, Dad loved the people, all of the people. And the messages and comments from fans and colleagues demonstrate the impact he had on others. Some of those messages that we received. One of the best, maybe even the best person I have ever met in my entire life. Truly one of the nicest and most genuine people I ever knew. Leo always had a smile on his face. One of the best, if not the best. Your dad was the very best of men in all ways. Your dad was one of the nicest people I have ever gotten to know. He really was one of a kind. Leo was a prince among men. Truly the most genuine, selfless, and caring person I met in my 40 years in sports. My idol and role model. Professionally and personally. And of course, Jeffrey Lurie, who said, Mr. Carlin kept the personal in the ticketing world and was able to keep the Eagles and our customers and community as one. And that is pretty special, end quote. Dad did it all with love, humility, and a smile. I have lost four very important people in my life over the last couple years. Jane Goggin, Bob Goggin, Bill McGovern, and now my hero. Loss is hard. Loss can be devastating if you allow it. I do take comfort in knowing that all of them are smiling down on us. And of course, knowing those three men well, I am sure they are sitting at the table with Jesus, telling him, that whole water into wine thing was impressive, but can you step it up to some brown water, please? Dad taught us that even the most profound loss is survivable, as the cracks in our hearts are just openings that God created to allow the love to flow in. Loss solidifies the foundations of love. That is what God intended. A dear friend made me aware of a short paragraph written by Donna Ashworth that I feel is most appropriate today. I'd like to share it with you. Quote, "You don't move on after loss, but you move with. You must shake hands with grief, welcome her in, for she lives with you now. Pull her a chair at the table and offer her comfort. She is not the monster you first thought her to be. She is love. And she will walk with you now, stay with you now peacefully, if you let her. And on the days when your anger is high, remember why she came. Remember who she represents. Remember, grief came to you, my friend, because love came first. Love came first." End quote. Love always came first with Dad. I received a t-shirt in the mail a couple weeks ago from that same family friend and her daughters. It said Leo across the front. The daughter was a student at Indiana University, and the former football coach there started every season with Leo on the chalkboard in the locker room, and he handed out the t-shirt to his players. He was trying to create the right culture and to teach them that nothing was more important than for them to love each other. Leo, an acronym for Love Each Other. The name fits my dad perfectly. So let's all love each other in these trying times, as Dad would have wanted. Let's take care of one another and be kind to each other. And when it is our time, there is one thing for sure. As he always was, Dad will be standing at the gates with your tickets to get in. Congratulations, Dad, on a job very well done. And thank you for such a magical life. We love you.
Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us. Oh, we did this.
We did it.
Yeah, sorry, we did that already. That was wrong.
One day.
On behalf of the Carlin family, we'd like to thank everyone for attending the funeral mass today at St. John Newman. The burial is going to be private at Calvary Cemetery. However, you are welcome to join the family for the memorial luncheon at Overbrook Golf Club, located on Godfrey Road in Bryn Mawr. Thank you.
have seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. I can read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His day is